This conference will now be recorded.
How it works, we'll check that as well. Right, so any questions? So far, are you comfortable and I hope you are following, right? So, one minute, I'm just trying to, earlier there is a, the way we used to download this is a bit different. Now there is a complete change in download of this. You see that, one minute. There is a change now, actually earlier they were giving something like Cloudera Director. You don't have Cloudera Director. This is new, actually I'm seeing this new for the first time. Just a minute, we'll continue. It's more related to the cloud actually. Now they have given to the cloud actually. There is a lot of changes happening with Cloudera. Okay, we'll see this. Now let's continue. I'll check this part again a little later. They was talking about these things. Like, what are those things? It's higher HBase, all these HBases we are talking one by one. Then what is that? Let me just open the image so that it's easy for us to follow. So there are so many ecosystems right there. Then pig, let me talk about pig now. What is this pig and why do we need pig? Piggy actually, no, it's not, it's more like it's used for implementing some scripting. Earlier, before we have Spark, okay, prior to Spark, you know, if you want to do any cleaning operations, like, you know, if you want to see, cleaning in sense, you know, what do you mean by cleaning, right? If you have a data set, you need to check the nulls. You need to check spaces, or if you want to perform any transformations. The best thing people used to do is like three, four years back, not now. The pig days were gone. Okay. So when 3-4 years back, people used to use pig for, you know, writing some scripts by using a language called, there is something called pig Latin. Using this pig Latin, what happens is we write a language. We write a script actually. Okay, and it's more like it's a very simple script, and it has a very simple type of coding style, you know, basic and coding syntaxes. It's more look like a kind of, no, it's a kind of script as well as used to do some querying kind of thing with this pig Latin script. Okay, 1 minute, guys, be online.
Not able to hear you anything?
Manohar took a gap.
Yeah, sorry guys. There is a call phone, some important call had come. Okay, I was talking about Pig Latin. Let's continue. No, Babu, I think I was unmute actually. So I need to take some important call. Now, going back to this Pig Latin is something, you know, we write scripts with this and it's a simple language. Okay, so that's what this Pig is all about. You know, it is used to write up scripts for performing what operations. You know, as name says, you know, if you remember Pig, you know, what is that you remember about Pig? Okay, the basic functionality of pigs. You know, even having pigs in the ecosystem is very good. I'm talking about the real pigs, not the pig language. So why do we need that? You know, the advantage of having pigs in ecosystem is they perform cleaning. If you remember that the canals, everything, they do some cleaning, isn't it or not? So that's what this Pig Latin is. Even here also it performs cleaning. See, these people have named these ecosystems. Bringing that real-time use cases, the real-time, you know, real-world this thing to the applications. That's what they have done. Okay. So the point is, it is used to write scripts for performing cleaning operations. Anyhow, I will introduce like how the scripts will work and how we can work with the scripts, all that. So that is one more thing. So this is a simple introduction to Pig. I am not going too deeper into this discussion now. I'm just introducing each ecosystem. I want to close this quickly. And first I want to, you know, first give us a roadmap, like how to continue, what topics we should start now for the coming sessions, and how we plan our sessions. All this has to be discussed today. Then we start the next phase of learning, okay? Because we almost have learned the fundamental level of this big data, like, you know, the HDFS architecture, which relates to the admin. Okay. Next, okay. Pig Latin is fine now. Then after that, the other important area is MapReduce. What is this? We have a basic idea. What is MapReduce means? It is a processing engine which takes care of processing. In Hadoop 1.x. So that is one thing, true, no doubt about that. MapReduce is a processing engine. Usually takes care of processing, which performs, which executes otherwise, which executes tasks. That is one thing. Next one. In a MapReduce, there are two different things. When you talk about MapReduce, usually MapReduce is completely implemented in Java. Okay, so what it does is it uses Java. That is one thing. Usually, mostly MapReduce demand Java, but still you can also implement MapReduce with the Python as well. It uses Java or Python, but in most of the cases people use Java. They don't use Python. Python is something which is used in a few cases. Okay, it uses Java or Python. That is one thing. But nowadays, of course, when you come to Spark, people use Scala. Okay, it uses Java or Python. That is one. But which is mostly used with the MapReduce? Java. Earlier, you know, I still remember 3 years back, most of the learners. Because learners, in a sense, most of the people don't come from a programming background. They might come from a data warehouse background. They might come from a database background, which are non-programming backgrounds. I used to see, like, you know, 70 to 80% of the people coming from non-programming backgrounds. I'm not saying it is wrong, but this MapReduce is something which people used to worry, like I still remember, like 3-4 years back, because it has Java. And it has Java, I used to see people first, they used to ask me this question: there is Java, can we learn this map? Yeah, that is one thing that is there in the previous days, but mostly MapReduce is implemented with Java. It uses something called internally map and reduce, mappers and reducers. Okay, so we'll just see this, how this mappers and reducers work. I'll explain the architecture of map reducer. Also, we can write customized code. Of course, map reduce can be used in two ways. Suppose you run a Hive job, you run a H based job, or you run different other jobs internally, map reduce might run. For at least for Hive, map reduce job definitely run. For Hive, it may or may not run. Okay, for H based, we might have a map reduce job directly running or not. But for Hive, we can see that a map reduce job running in the background of this Hive, you know, queries or Hive tuning things. We can see that, we can practically observe that, we don't have an issue there. Okay, so point is, that is one thing. Means at infra side, this map reduce do some processing. That is one thing. But also we can write customized code. Like you can also do the cleaning. You know, one approach is by using pig, all that stuff. Earlier people used to do this cleaning of data, applying transformations. They used to do different sorts of things with map reduce only. Okay, so means what? MR is also used to do is also used to write a customized code. Okay, right? Customized code. There will be map function and reduce function inside map reduce libraries. There will be a lot of Java libraries. All this has a rich set of Java libraries. When you have that, you know, you just try to use them, and you override those methods from map reduce libraries. There is a map method, reduce method, and you try to build in some classes, Java classes, to implement the code. And that code is a customized code. Again, I am explaining here. This code is used to do some cleaning, some transformations, some connecting to database. Everything, you know, we can do all sorts of things with MapReduce, but whatever we can do nowadays in Spark, that can be done in MapReduce. Earlier people used to do there, but what is the challenging point is not everyone is ready to work with Java. That is one thing. I don't say, I'm not criticizing Java is bad, guys. I'm just telling you the market situation. Second thing, of course, performance wise, it's not about MapReduce is difficult. Okay. Performance wise, even MapReduce is not that efficient. You know, if you talk about Spark is, people say that 100 times faster than MapReduce. Okay, but nowadays when 3.x came, at least they have optimized, that they have leveraged the performance issues of MapReduce. But still, this is the history, you know. MapReduce thing, you don't need to worry about it. That's what I would like to tell. Nowadays we don't have MapReduce. People are not trying to work with this. MR is also used to write customized programs. Customized means developer, which we write, written by us, is called customization. Okay, what kind of customized programs, like cleaning of data, like what else we do, like cleaning, like transformations. Might be, if you ask me, what is that transformation? So this seems little new for us. See, like, let me take two examples. Cleaning in sense, suppose you have a data set. You know, this data set, sometimes, you know, I can tell with small example. Every day we get some JSONs or CSV files. You know, JSON is in the form of key and value. It's in the form of key and value. It looks like this, okay? Something like name colon. Of course, it has a root again. Something like, you know, it has some name like this, some person, okay, colon. You have to put some braces there. It looks like this. I'm just giving a quick idea to explain about some person colon. Again, we have to open person. Inside that, you give the person details, name, colon. Sometimes I don't give any value. I put some empty space. Okay. And some age. I might give some value for age like this. I'm just giving you a quick idea what is cleaning. Okay. I have a date also as well. So date might be in some format. Okay. You know, usually how date formats are, you know, you have different date formats like some 2020 hyphen some 2 hyphen and then 20. This is one date format. What is this YYY and then MMDD? That is this format. What is this format? Is YYY and then MMDD. Okay. There are two things if you observe in this JSON file. What are those two things? One is we have empty values here for name and age. Means while processing, I cannot store empty as empty. I have to convert this to that empty strings must be converted to some null values and I should store in the database. That is one thing. So that's what we call cleaning. When any such values. And second thing, when you have any keep nulls also, validate nulls. Suppose if some so and so attribute is null, I should do something or I should not do something. That is what we do in a real time thing. Okay. The second thing, transformations in sense, now I am using date as a YYY MMDD, but sometimes you know it might be the opposite. It might be DD MMYY. You know, in Indian, this thing we use first we write date and then month and then year. So now I want the date in that format. Then I should convert that date from this format to our format. That is called transformation, converting one format to another format. Usually it happens for dates and currencies, all this stuff. But in our project, I see most transformations are applied for dates also. While trying to concatenate keys, they apply certain kind of transformations. So all these sorts of things we can implement with MapReduce. Whatever we can do here, the same thing we can apply with Pig also. The same thing we can do with Spark as well. You got it, right? But people nowadays prefer to use which one? MapReduce or Spark? We use Scala, we don't use Java. I think this is clear for all of you, right? Any more questions on this so far? Then after that, what else we have? The other ecosystems. Let me just open the image and then quickly finish this now. Today we will close all this. Then if anything missing, we'll discuss. We'll probably try to download that Cloudera. There is one more challenging for us. This is actually, if you look at this, this is one of the big data resume. And you can see there are so many things here. This talks about HDFS. Yesterday we were discussing, right? So even in interviews, people ask a bit of things about HDFS, but not more about which one. Mostly nowadays people don't talk about what is the name node, what is data node. I don't think people still are interested in such things. Now if you look at this, I spoke about PIG, I spoke about HDFS, I spoke about HBase, I spoke about MapReduce, I spoke about HIO, I spoke about what is that term? These are the basic things so far. Now Scoop. One more important thing is, what is a scoop here? Why do we need scoop? Understand carefully. Scoop actually is very useful and very powerful. It's a very simple tool. The purpose of scoop, it is a migration tool, data migration. Scoop is a data migration tool. The purpose of this is, it is used to move data from one ecosystem to other ecosystem. Move data from one ecosystem to other ecosystem. That is one thing. And here ecosystems, suppose I want to move data from Hive to RDBMS. Okay. Or RDBMS to Hive. Or Hive to HBase. Or HBase to Hive. Means you can do anything. This side this way to that way or that way to this way. So RDBMS to okay, and etc. I told you, right? Hive to HBase, HBase to Hive, like this. And HDFS to Hive, Hive to HDFS. Okay, I think you get the point, right? So what is the point here? This is, you know, we are trying to move data in different different sources to other sources. For that, what I can tell is Scoop is one of the best tool to perform, and it's very easy and simple also. So that's what that is the usage of Scoop here. For it, right? It's a data migration tool. Next one. Avro, I think we are not using this. Some kind of RPC means remote process communication. And Mahout, probably it is used for handling some machine learning. That is fine. We generally don't use Mahout as well. Nowadays, for machine learning, all in one, we have Spark to handle something like related to machine learning. We have Spark thing. Then UGI. OGI is a scheduling tool actually. Scheduling means, you know, right, what job has to be run, okay, which job should be run. We just schedule all the jobs one by one as per date, as per time, as per intervals, as per you know, this thing. Many things will be updated in that schedulers. So based on that, your Hadoop will executing the jobs. So that's what OGI. But it differs, but actually not all the projects will have the same schedulings. Okay, in some kind of projects we have something like autosys, in some kind of projects we have some other things. Okay, so in that way scheduling tools may not be the same from company to company or project to project. It might change. Okay, so but anyhow, don't worry, you don't deal with scheduling because there will be already schedulers written by some other team and you'll be utilizing it. Usually it happens in production. Scheduling thing happens with production. Okay, so there we need to update that scheduling thing there, but still that will be implemented by some other team as well. And Flume, now what is Flume? Flume here, see, Flume is a streaming tool. It means it is used to process live data. So the purpose of Flume is it is a streaming. Okay, it's a streaming tool. Which is used to process. What do we need this? Which is used to process live data. Live data. Or streaming data, otherwise anything is fine, guys. There is a small typo here. Okay, it is used to process some streaming data. Streaming means, you know, the best example of streaming is you need to process log files. Suppose if you take a real-time use case, log files, you know, the logs keep generated in web servers, real-time web servers, all that. From time to time you have to, you know, get that logs and you have to put it into some dedicated place. So what you have to do, you keep on doing this, you know, we have to get that log files from the particular you know, server, and we have to read it and we have to again keep it into some specific location in your Hadoop. So for that, people prefer to use what? Flume. Not just log data. There will be different, you know, Flume can be used in different ways. I just have given you the best example of you know, using Flume in a real-time scenarios. Okay, people try to use more in many cases to read this log data, log files. Okay, and still there are so many use cases, like, you know, even if you see that streaming instance, you see a camera, right, webcam, right, that CC cams, even that is a data actually, you know. That CC cams continuously will be generating data. Even to, you know, stream such data, we use this you know, Flume. Even in YouTube, you see a live session is being telecasted. Even if you want to just stream all those kind of files, okay? Means stream instance not giving live. No, I want to bring all this data and put it into some dedicated location. This Flume is very useful. We'll talk about it in detail. I'm just only briefing on this. Okay, I'm not going too deeper into this discussion. Maybe we can again, what is that? Talk one. Flume, we'll discuss at least some two sessions. For two sessions, we'll have a detail. Two or three sessions, I'll talk about Flume. Chukwa means monitoring. Monitoring means, you know, right? It takes care of, see all the how the resources are happening and which is utilizing more, which is less. All this comes under Chukwa. I think we are not using much of, I think I didn't hear much of this in our day-to-day work as well. But Zookeeper, I think we keep hearing about this. This is actually the coordination tool. You know, what is a zookeeper? In a zoo, there will be so many animals, and those animals are managed by the zookeeper, isn't it or not? So even these names, I told you, right? We got these names from a real terminology. So what zookeeper does is it coordinates all the different resources existing in the ecosystem, all the different services in the ecosystem. As name says, zookeeper, it looks after each and every ecosystem and coordinating the services and managing the services. Everything is done by the zookeeper. So that's why, you know, when you talk of administrative people, have a definitely have a bigger picture about zookeeper, because they do a lot of you know, this thing on this zookeeper as well. Okay, so what do we need this? This is a coordination tool used for monitoring, used for managing the services, There will be so many services in this Hadoop. All those services are monitored and managed by whom? Zookeeper. Okay, and then Kafka. What Kafka does? Kafka is also a most happening live tool actually nowadays. You know, this is used for handling streaming data, live data. Same like, you know, Flume. This is a Flume has some setbacks, some limitations. To overcome these limitations, people have introduced Kafka, but still sometimes we use you know, Flume and Kafka together. That is also there, so we don't need to worry that even though it has some limitations, still Flume is used in certain projects. But why Kafka was introduced? Because it is much more sophisticated than Flume, and this is also used to handle what data? It is also used to handle streaming data. Okay, that is one thing. And streaming instance, just now I told you what is streaming, like what kind of data comes out of that. So there are so many types of streaming data. We don't need to worry too much about it. We'll talk more on this. I'm just only introducing the ecosystems. I'm not talking about every ecosystem now in detail. Okay, this is just a brief discussion. Then it has something like producer and consumer, two basic services in Kafka. You know, if you understand that producer and services, mostly we are done with Kafka. There will be something called topics, where we write data to topics and we write data from topics. That's how Kafka works. So that is very interesting topic actually, you know, and very useful. Nowadays people are using Kafka a lot in the projects. Even if you look at this guy's resume, just now I have shown some resume. If it is open, I can show you. If it is closed, okay, fine, anyhow. Little later, I will show you how it works. So that's about Kafka part, okay? Then the last one. So this is all about Hadoop now. So mostly, I spoke in detail about most of the stuff, at least a clear conversation happened about different ecosystems. Also, all the differences between Hadoop 1x, 2x, and 3x. Also, what is that? Now we have a clear understanding about the services. So all this thing had happened now. Okay. Kafka will come under data management. See, everything in Hadoop comes under data management only, because we are dealing with a big data this thing, right? So all this comes under data management, no doubt about that, Babu. But the point is how this data management is happening is the important thing. Okay, so in certain cases we try to process some periodical data, in certain process we try to process some live data, some there are different types of way of handling this data. Okay, handling batch data, handling streaming data, handling some other forms of unstructured data. So in this way, there are different types of data. So depends on that, a specific tool is used in processing data. We'll understand that. We don't need to worry or hurry this time because we are in the very beginning. So that's it. Now we have a clear picture about Hadoop. Okay, this is Hadoop. So what should we learn from this Hadoop stack, which are very important, where you have to focus? Means, see, understanding all this at basic level is important, no doubt about that. But your focus area should be this Hive and HBase. Yesterday, you know, I was just talking to some US guy, completely an US architect, senior architect. He's a US citizen, not Indian, he's an American. So when I'm talking to him, what he's asking for his for project requirements is, he's talking about some his project thing. He is having Hive requirement. Well, you know, usually our discussion happened like that. I'm telling him, our project, we use HBase, all this stuff. So in certain projects, people prefer to use HBase. In certain projects, people prefer to use Hive, because when you are going for more analysis, Hive is much more recommended. If you are going for more storage, as well as if you are doing read operations, HBase is more recommended. So both are useful. You have to learn both. And even we were talking about what kind of concepts we use in Hive. Usually people use something called indexing and bucketing, most important things there. Sorry, that is partitioning and bucketing. That is the most important concept of Hive people use, because tuning is the most important part of all this. And generally data tuning happens with this partitioning and bucketing. Okay. So learning these two is good. Pig days were gone. This is actually became an old hero now, so it cannot dance, it cannot act now. Okay, but point is outdated. I don't say it's bad or it is not useless, but the only thing is people are not recommending this because of Spark. The better performer came now, more than Pig. Spark is having a lot of libraries, as well as Spark gives you a best performance, so that's why pig days were outdated. Then MapReduce is still there when you run Hive or pig jobs. Even if you run Pig also, behind that MapReduce runs. But nowadays even you can integrate Spark engine in place of MapReduce to Hive and Pig as well. Of course, Pig is almost I don't think people are using nowadays, but still what I'm trying to tell is that Spark execution engine, we can set it to Hive also. Suppose there is a MapReduce engine behind Hive. Now engine instance, don't think like car engine, bus engine, don't imagine that. No, these are all services. Okay, so because of these services, what happens, our applications will keep running. So point is, this takes care of, this gives an environment for running an application. So we can integrate Spark with Hive or Spark with Pig in place of MapReduce nowadays. That is also there. That will be done by the administrators if required. There will be properties available in the XMLs. So you, based on that, we can change that. I'm just giving you a bigger picture of everything nowadays. Suppose if somebody asks in interviews, can I change the execution engine? Means definitely, if not Spark, even in 2x or 3x, you can use Tej behind the processing engines. Your engine can change nowadays. Got it, right? So Scoop is good to have. Still people are using in some projects, people are still using Scoop. And then Plume, understanding a bit of Zookeeper is good for you. And also, what else? Kafka, even Kafka is good for us. Among all this stuff, Kafka, learning Kafka is also good for you because it adds a strong weight to the resume. So these are all different things what we need in, you can skip few things here. What are those few things? You don't need to go for too much of programming for MapReduce. which we need like, you know, 2-3 years back. We just have some basic understanding and the architecture of MapReduce and how mapper works, how reducer works. Once mono to small applications on MapReduce is enough for us, more than sufficient. That's that you can talk to the interviewer that, okay, we are not working on this area, it's not useful now. Then see, in interview, it's all about how you convince that interviewer. Suppose interviewer is asking something which you don't know, which is not in your resume, then you can tell him straight away, okay, hey, just check that resume. You're asking something which I don't know or which is not in resume. I didn't work on that. That is the advantage an experienced guy has, where a fresher don't have that choices. Okay. So you can tell the interviewer, like you can insist him or you can, you know, force him, like, you know, to switch to this. Second thing is, interviewer is, it's like, you know, doing an interview is an art. You know, what interviewer is asking is, he asks something, but you have to, you know, intelligently bring him to the your strength area. So wherever you are strong, you have to slowly bring him to that area and you have to put him there. You have to, you know, make him wait there and keep on asking questions in your, you know, so whatever you are familiar with, got it, right? That's so that's an art you have to improve. That will talk slowly one by one. So got it, right? So I think I have clearly updated what you should know. But now the problem with Hadoop stack is MapReduce became old. No, it is not that up to that standard. And the performance issues are there with MapReduce. That is why, you know, and also there is a pig there. Again, it is doing some cleaning. And the way you write, it's more like pig is using pig Latin. But, you know, now what happened? But these were not that useful nowadays because of introduced to Spark. You know, completely we are not depending on Hadoop now. A new big data framework was introduced to the market apart from Hadoop now. What is that? Now we also have Spark. Now today, when you look at the job market, without Spark, you don't find 95% of the jobs, job JDs, because that is most happening technology nowadays, you know, big data framework. And good thing about Spark is it provides a lot of performance, okay? It provides so Spark, what it does, it is a big data framework. What it does, big data framework, which is used to, it is also used to process data. It is a processing engine, process and analyze data with the better performance. And people generally say that it is 100 times better, you know, provides better performance than MapReduce. That is one thing. But usually it's on paper. Okay. If you look into the tuning at architect level, how it works is something we have to analyze. Okay. Excuse me. Is it clear now? Next one. There are so many things under the belt of Spark, okay, under the umbrella of Spark. We have Spark Core, Spark SQL, Spark Streaming, Spark ML, Machine Learning. Nowadays, even data science people use Spark actually, because if you learn Spark very well, even for performing predictions and data, the data science people are also using the Spark as a tool for them, so which is very useful to you, okay? That is one more thing. Got it, right? So there are so many, you know, this thing, categories under Spark. Again, we have Spark Core, which we should, everybody should learn this. There is no choice for us. And then Spark SQL, Spark Streaming, and then Spark. Even there in that Spark Streaming, we can integrate Kafka with Spark. That is also there. That is possible. And then what else we can use? Spark ML. We can also deal with the graph databases, Spark Graphics, something. There are so many things, guys. I don't need to write everything. When we talk about Spark, we will talk about all that stuff, okay? Etc. We can put TTC here. But so that is another framework. So there are a couple of things which were outdated in Hadoop. Nowadays, Hadoop stack doesn't have that priority. So there is actually a new things keep on coming in the market. You have to upgrade that as well. That is one thing is Spark. And Spark uses, we can implement Spark either with Scala. This is the default language that Spark chooses, or we implement it with Java, or we implement it with the Python. Okay. Again, same thing. When I was talking to this American architect yesterday, what's happening there, gentlemen? That architect is okay. He's saying one thing. What is that one thing? Either he prefers to use Scala or Python in that implementation. If it is Python, we use something called PySpark. If it is Scala, means by default, that is actually the proprietary for Spark, because most of the Spark libraries are implemented in Scala. Scala is again written in Java, but even though it is written in Java, but you are not learning Java here, but it is a Scala. Okay, Scala is having a bit, it looks like a bit of Python program. Okay, so the syntaxes are a bit similar to Python, and Scala has a similar syntaxes. If you are interested, you can, anyhow, we talk more of the Scala as well. So now, what shall we learn then? What do we have to learn first? So this is all about your big data. And if you learn all this, definitely what happens, you are ready for your job, and then you can start attending the interview. Understood now? So these things you have to master now. So what is that? One thing is, and also the basic Unix commands. I think I had discussed, did I discuss any Unix commands with you? So that is one thing. I think I had discussed in the early sessions. Did we finish discussing Unix commands and HDFS commands? I hope so, right?
Just introduction has completed, sir.
Yeah. Now those commands are enough, actually. HDFS and Unix commands, whatever we learned is enough. We don't need more of that. While working with Flume is not just for ingesting an unstructured data. It is used to, you know, do, of course, whenever we talk about streaming data, streaming can be an unstructured data as well, because it might have, you know, what is that, logs, or it might have, what is that, this MP4 video files, or you know, because, you know, streaming in sense mostly it's more like a video file or this kind of data. So it's not like we try to put it into HDFS, Madhu. Even you know, we put it into some dedicated storage point. Okay, that is also there. So it depends how you configure that Flume. It depends on that. Got it, right? So, and if the requirement is, if you want to store all that files in HDFS, then you have to put it. Otherwise, usually what you do is you try to store somewhere in the dedicated path. In the local machine, that is also there. Yeah, as you say, ingestion in sensor. So ingestion is moving that data from some different source to or get it to the local machine. Once you get into the local machine, how you are going to read it and how you are going to process it depends on the way you are trying to implement it. Okay, that anyhow we'll see. So now we have finished this Unix commands. What you have to do is, which one we should start on priority? That is the important thing we should plan now. From Monday, which topic should we pick up? So if you talk about the job requirement, let me just show you this guy's resume, because that's easy for you to follow. I will show you. I put somewhere here in. Look at this guy's resume. Okay, see this now. If you look at it, mostly the tools you can see, because this is one of the, this is for applied for a 10 plus or more. Sorry, it's applied for a 6 years. Leave about cloud environment. Now we are not targeting cloud. Mostly cloud is something which will be happening in coming days. Okay, but if you look at it, what are the major things in this project? If you see here, whatever we have discussed so far, you can see HDFS, Hadoop, Hadoop instance, all this comes under Hadoop. Scoop, Hive, HBase, Pig, Cloudera, Zookeeper. He's saying that, you know, all this, but he don't really use in the project. Okay. So Uzi, MapReduce, Evero, we almost all whatever we discussed so far. Solar Kafka. For Solar instance, I can even talk on that. It's actually, you know, as name says, the purpose of Solar is for querying, actually, for efficient querying. People use Solar. Okay. But fine, no issues. Now see here, what is that he put in his resume? Just a sample. This is actually used for some, you know, somebody is doing some use of that stuff. And you can see here now, this is an important area. Okay, and you can see here pipelining with the Spark and Hive. And you can see most of the time he is talking more on Spark only. Can you see this? He is highlighting Spark uses with HDFS. And see, I'm giving you, you know, like exactly like what you need to prepare and how you have to prepare. And Kafka, you can see Kafka is also, you know, it increases weight to your resume nowadays. Okay. But in a real time, sometimes it will be most fun. I was talking to one of my old student. He learned Java from me and he is working in Accenture. I'll tell you a funny part here. Sometimes how your work will be, you don't have work at all. His responsibilities were just running a Kafka job. Just he has to go and just run some Kafka jobs and go home. That's all. A 2-hour job every day. Because he is running jobs without fail, he got 21% hike this year. Understood? So that's how it is. Sometimes, you know, your job might be so simple, actually. What he has to do is just run those jobs and just keep quiet. So it will take care of loading or streaming. Everything will be done. Because they have some frameworks, that frameworks keep take care of doing it. Even we have certain frameworks and loading data. But we have work every day. We have to do some analysis and we have to figure out so much of things happens to us at a core level. Okay. But it's that sometimes your work will be very limited. And if you want to relax, such kind of projects definitely very helpful. But still, if you want learning, then you should not be in such projects as well. That is also suggested. Clear, right? That's all, guys. This is our idea about this. What shall we start now? The high priorities is, yeah, Spark is something. Mostly people talk more on Spark first. And then people talk about HDFS, no doubt about that. People talk about Hive, people talk about HBase. So, 1 minute, guys. I'm getting the call, I need to take it. Yeah, guys, sorry. So first you target this, but these are not enough. Here you have to first start with some language first. You know, learn either Scala, give a high priority Scala if you are going with big data, then next priority to Python and next priority to Java. Okay, if you ask me, sir, should we learn all these things? Okay, at least be good with Scala, leave about Python and Java. But if you have that time and leverage, if you want to leverage all this, then you go for Python. Still, if you want to learn Java, go for Java. Got it, right? This is all about this one here. So, what shall we do now? Shall we, and then, of course, also learn Kafka. Along with this, try to understand Flume and also OG, get some quick idea about OG. Okay. Just to make sure that your resume is strong enough to talk in the interview. Okay, I keep on talking like how to prepare resumes and how to handle interviews, what kind of questions we need to face. Even we see that, we have discussed HDFS, right? And we have discussed differences between 1x to x3x. You can just quickly go through the interview questions, like, Hadoop interview questions. Like, then you understand like what you are learning. Okay, somewhere you can take some, just pick a quick idea here, okay? So you have to just take it like this. We didn't finish MapReduce, okay? There are some things which we finished. What is that? We have discussed like HDFS. I'll just only just show you quickly before going to discuss more on this. Interview questions on HDFS. Let's see this. And you can see now what is Hadoop distribution. See, people don't ask these simple questions. What is name node and data node in HDFS? We have discussed all this, right? What is Hadoop? You can see here. Quick HDFS questions. You can see from this guy in its data flare. So most of this still you can answer. It's right. Few things related to admin you cannot. You can skip them. You can talk them. But when you look at this, how you are, how good you are, at least you get some idea. How these discussions are happening, are helping you, at least are you getting something useful to you? You can see all that stuff. And while going through a couple of interview questions, you get a clear idea, like, still you can enhance that understanding of the subject. Because suppose you see this question which fascinates me is, explain HDFS, read once, write many packets. What is this exactly? We have a detailed discussion. HDFS is a storage. It follows something like WORA, okay? Means write once, read anywhere, that's what it is, or read many times. So that's what HDFS is, right? It is used to store data. Usually we keep it for one time, and from there onwards, we keep on reading data from HDFS. And that's what this is, read once, write once, read many means, that is one thing. And you see here, what happens when name node goes down? We have a discussion on this. During the file read operation in Hadoop. Okay, that is, what happens when name node is, if it is 1x, then automatically file reading is going to be, it's going to be terminated. That is one thing. So, if it is 1x, if it is 2x and 3x, there will be active name node. Then in place of name node going down, that active name node comes in the picture. How to create users in Hadoop? That is one thing, HDFS, okay? That is actually purely related to the administration. Even you can try it in your local machine, sir. I'm just quickly showing you, how you can see, at least when you look at it, you can at least get some idea. You feel like, okay, I have some idea on this. I have some idea. What is Hadoop? You can answer this. What is Hadoop distributed file system? You can answer this. What is distributed file system? I have explained in detail. It is stored in the form of blocks, and it implements parallel processing. You remember, right? So all these things happens with this Hadoop distributed file system. What is name node and data node? You can answer this. How name node tackles data node failure? We can answer this. We have discussed that. What do you mean by metadata in Hadoop? What is metadata? In which location name node stores its metadata, and why? This anyhow, I need to check it once, sir. So there will be some default locations. You can even try that. Okay. How much metadata? Even this question, I need to check it once, sir. When name node enter in safe mode, when name node enters to safe mode, okay. You can, these are some questions are related to admin as well. Okay, clear, right? So the part governance thing, 1 minute, guys. I think that is. Okay, fine. That's it, guys. You can see here, some are related to the admin as well. We don't directly deal. I told you, right, we never see name node. We don't see where this name node metadata is stored, all that. Okay, just the basic understanding, that is more enough for me as a developer. Okay, how to restart name node? We don't restart name nodes. That's not our responsibility, but still you can see the answer. Like, what is block size? Why is block size large in Hadoop? And then what is a block in HDFS? You can answer why block is, this is actually targeted for 1.x. Nowadays it is 128. When you look at all this, at least after the discussion happened for 1 week, you can correlate with these questions at least. Okay, you get some idea. What is heartbeat in Hadoop? You know, see, most of the questions, at least you understand if you know the answer or not. Leave that answer part. Got it, right? What is secondary name node? You can see this. You can at least, how does HDFS helps name node in scaling in Hadoop? You know, what is scaling? Scalability, we had a discussion. How often data node send heartbeat to name node? We had a discussion. See, at least out of this, what I can tell is, if you have how many here, some 40 or 50 questions, you will be comfortable with most of this. Erasure coding, yesterday we have discussed. Yesterday or day before yesterday, what is it? In 3x, while seeing the differences, we had a discussion. But we didn't go on into the detailing. What is rack awareness means? You know, something, you know, distributing data in the form of racks, your servers, and then something which is near to the, you know, trying to allocate data into the data nodes, which is near to the that name node or the job trackers or yarn, that is what we call rack awareness here. Anyhow, you can check it once. Got it, right? Why I'm showing all this is what you have learned in this 1 week. At least, did you get reasonable knowledge from these sessions? That's what I'm trying to show you. So that when you look at this interview questions, okay, from whichever the website it might be, you can go through any website of your choice. Okay. So, and still now you are in a position to understand better all these things. If you go through these interview questions, and if you try to read them, you get a bigger picture now, because you have that standard discussion happened so far within this 1 or 2, like for last Wednesday, right? We started our sessions last Wednesday to Friday. Almost we have 8 day session happened so far. Eight sessions. No, you then Saturday and Sunday. Okay. We have at least some 6 sessions we have done continuously. Got it, right? So what shall we start now? You tell me. The high priority goes to which one? Shall we start with Scala first and then scale? Shall we focus on the most happening thing in the industry? Shall we start with this first? Because this is very useful. And then scale. We can start with Scala first. Okay. So from Monday, I start Scala. Start learning Scala well. That is a language. It is very useful for everyone. Okay. And mostly, if I am going to tell you this, I'm not saying that because I am teaching you Scala. In the industry, not many people know Scala, or not many people are Scala teaching, training Scala the way it has to be trained. So, but we go a little deeper into the understanding of that, because your Spark completely depends on Scala thing. Okay, got it, right? So that's how. But once you do it, you should be in a position to write your own codes, your own functions or UDFs, like that. You have to be playing with your Spark, because Spark completely uses Scala internally. For everything, it uses Scala code only. Got it, right? So majority of the people are asking for Scala. From tomorrow, we start with that. Got it, right? And before that, I have to show you how to download your Cloudera distribution. That once I show you that, I start with scale-up. How to install and then how to run it. Then we start with the scale in the next session. That is on Monday. Because tomorrow and day after tomorrow, we have a, this is a weekend. I have Python weekend sessions here. Azure, I think, I didn't explain anything much about it, you know, Krishnan, because what is that? We are not that much into that concept actually so far. We don't usually, that blocks are what else? Replications, that is one thing usually we use in HDFS. Azure thing we'll see in the next session, okay? As you are asking, okay? If it is required, I told you, right? Whatever it is required to understand development, I'll talk on that. If it is not necessary, you can explore yourself. I have given, I will tell you like this is this, so you can at least get, go and explore it. Still, if you have issues, we might discuss, okay? Okay, then. Any more questions apart from all this? One thing remaining is installation of Cloudera distribution. Remind me on Monday if I switch to Scala directly. So that first I'll show you how to install it. It will take some 20 to half an hour. Once that is done, you can start. Can you share Python class time link? See, Python sessions happens always at 10 a.m. in the morning on the weekends, okay? And Saturday and Sunday. Sometimes it's not